Newsmax host Greg Kelly celebrated the idea of totally annihilating Gaza. Take a look.
And Israel right now is doing a fantastic job pounding Gaza night and day. It's exactly what they deserve. Take a look at the from the ground perspective, what it looks like. I mean, it's kind of hard to believe though, as this to me looks like total victory, right? Total annihilation. Doesn't work that way. You still have to go in with the ground troops.
50% of the people who live in Gaza are children. Yes. The average age of a Gazan resident is 18 years old, and that was Greg Kelly. I don't mean to be crude, but horny at the idea of annihilating an entire group of people, gleefully cheering on the genocide of the Palestinian people. And just to give a little bit of context about the conditions, Greg Kelly, who's never suffered a moment in his life, the conditions that the people of Gaza have to live through, 97% of them don't have access to clean drinking water. Because they don't have access to clean drinking water, instances of kidney disease is particularly prevalent in Gaza. They don't have the medical equipment to be able to adequately treat those diseases because Israel won't let them have it. So they have to get special passes from the Israeli government to get treatment, which can and do get revoked for any or no reason whatsoever. The unemployment rate is 50%. The youth unemployment rate is 70%. There are previous liberation organizations that were more secular, more inspiring, were undermined by the Israeli state who bolstered and funded Hamas as recently as 2019. Benjamin Netanyahu is on the record speaking to members of his party in the Knesset, saying, in order to prevent the establishment of an Israeli state, we need to continue to bolster and send money to Hamas. I mean, these are the conditions that these people have to suffer through. And there is, again, Greg Kelly, who's never suffered a moment in his life, smiling in the face of genocide. Utterly repulsive.
As I said, about 50% of the population of Gaza were born in an open air prison. Their entire lives have been in an apartheid state. You can imagine what their lives are like. Their lives have already been foreclosed from the time they were born. The average life expectancy in Gaza, the last time I checked, is almost 30 years lower than life expectancy in the countries in the world with the highest life expectancy, which by the way is not us in the United States. It gets to the key point of what lives matter on this planet, right? Sub-Saharan Africans, their lives don't matter. They're drowned in the Mediterranean. Central Americans, their lives don't matter. You know, apprehend them at the Mexico-Guatemala border. Yemenis, their lives didn't matter. Ukrainians, their lives matter maybe a little bit more. What's going on here? It's very clear how this game is being set up for all of us. And I also just want to note, and you know, the Greg Kelly example is just one of many examples I've seen. I've been combing mainstream media, which drives me insane, as you know, over the last week or so, since Saturday. It's unbelievable to me how the shock that's been created out of this series of events has been used to legitimate and normalize the continued destruction and the amplification of violence by the Israeli state with the US and West's full backing. This is the shock doctrine. A very famous book by Naomi Klein that was written to discuss things like 9/11 and everything that happens afterward. And that's what we're seeing happening right in front of us right now. So again, I want to ask the Israeli state or the US government or whoever, Macron, anybody, what is your end game here? Is it the continued incarceration of Palestinian peoples, which clearly in and of itself, to your point, Cenk, is not really working? It might be working for the right wing Israeli government as well as Hamas, but it's not working for anyone else, right? It's not working for anyone else. What is their end game? Is it the collective annihilation of all Palestinians? Is it some sort of like, let's get back to having them in prison and be obedient servants? That didn't work because it got worse and worse and worse. What's their end game? What's their vision? Does any of that vision have any respect for Palestinian life, given that these are kids we're talking about?
Yeah. So what Netanyahu and the Israeli government is doing right now is incinerating the moral high ground. They had it. They had it for the first time and for so long. They had the moral high ground. And the whole world was with them, and we empathized. And you could say, hey, maybe the whole world wasn't with them, but a giant part of the world was with them. And even their critics, I have criticized the occupation for decades. And even I said, oh my God, look, my heart breaks right? It's because it's not even, there's a giant difference between opposing government action and killing civilians, okay? Now though, Netanyahu says, okay, let's help Hamas. Let's give them the moral high ground back. What are you doing? What are you doing? And so let's feed into their plan of making us look like the bad guys by being the bad guys. So are you, am I asking Israel for restraint even though they're badly hurt? Yes. You ask for the restraint not in good times. You ask for the restraint when you're hurt and we ask you to rise above it. And so that's for Israel. For the people that are monsters like Greg Kelly here in America. If you say, hey, listen, I love Israeli civilians, citizens, I have friends and family in Israel, etc. And they got hostages over there, we're gonna do what's necessary. We can argue and debate about what's necessary, okay? But I understand that. I understand that way of thinking. But when you celebrate the mass deaths of 583 children and say, looks like total victory to me, you're a disgusting person. So if you're out there and your heart broke for the Israelis and you understand the need for striking back and trying to get the hostages, etc., please do not cross over to celebrating. If you celebrate this death and destruction, then you're saying something about yourself as opposed to your enemies, okay?
And my heart is broken for all my Israeli brothers and sisters who have been targeted. And you know, a lot of these people at this music festival, they're probably people like me. I love going to music festivals. They were never the problem, right? But at the same time, it's just so important to recognize how this also could really help the Netanyahu regime, this shock doctrine, just like it helped George Bush. I'm not trying to make them totally equivalent. Right after 9/11, it helped Bush's vicious onslaught upon this world that we're living with still today. So as the Netanyahu regime becomes more and more authoritarian, more and more neo-fascist, cutting out the judiciary, this can give them a blank check to do whatever horrific things they want to do, recognizing that multiple members of this administration are already convicted for supporting terror against Palestinian peoples.
That is certainly possible, and that's why the right wing of all sides drive us to war and conflict, because they gain from it. But so far, the Israeli civilians, at least in the first poll, have proven way smarter than us, because 86% of them blame Netanyahu for getting the intelligence wrong and failing at his core job of protecting Israelis. And I think those Israeli civilians are exactly right. Do not get deluded by right-wing monsters who gain from war and conflict and death. Mm-hmm. Lay the blame where it belongs, 100% on Hamas, but also on the people who did not do the intelligence to protect you. And lastly, this is not for our host. I want you to think about this if you're in the audience. So let's say empathy for the Israelis, right? Your family. I want you to empathize, not theoretically, but feel it, okay? So you have to think about it, what if it happened to me? Your family gets brutally killed. I know I'd be in a rage. I'd be in a giant, uncontrollable rage, okay? And then they tell you, the guys who did it are in that building. But if you bomb that building, you're gonna get your revenge and you're gonna get your justice, but you're gonna kill 10 innocent civilians. Would you do it? Would you do it if it was 5 innocent people? And we use civilians and it sounds like almost war lingo. A grandmother, a child, an aunt, an uncle, and a sister. Would you bomb the building? You're gonna get the bad guys and you're gonna get your vengeance. And I know I would want righteous vengeance, okay? But those other, the 2 kids, the grandmother, it said they're gonna die. I hope you don't say yes. I know I wouldn't say yes. I'd rather storm the building myself to try to get the bad guys, but protect the grandmother and the 2 kids and the aunt and the uncle. I hope you say the same thing. But right now, as much as our heart went out to Israel in the beginning of the week and throughout the week, and it still goes out to them, to the civilians, please do not bomb the building. It's not the right thing to do. But that's the decision they're making. So, everyone, We're trying to get everyone to do the right thing. I know it's an impossible task, and especially after you've been hurt. But that's when heroes arise. Mm. That's also when bad guys arise. Mm. So right now, we haven't seen the heroes yet. I hope they arise out of Israel.
Thanks for watching. If you become a member, you get to watch all this ad-free, except for, of course, this ad. Still, hit the join button below.